हेलो फ्रेंड्स, तो वी आर इन अ वेरी डिफरेंट सेटिंग टुडे, दैट इज बिकॉज़ इज एक्चुअली माय ऑफिस एट यूडीपी एंड वी विल बी लुकिंग एट ए काइंड ऑफ डेमोंस्ट्रेशन ऑफ वन ऑफ द एक्सपेरिमेंट्स व्हिच इज देयर इन योर एमएससी प्रैक्टिकल लैब सिलेबस. ऑफ कोर्स ड्यू टू द पैंडेमिक कंस्ट्रेंट्स इट इज वेरी लाइकली दैट दिस एक्सपेरिमेंट कैन नॉट बी परफॉर्म फिजिकली in this current semester. Of course, when we do rejoin for physical laboratory sessions, definitely you will get a chance to actually handle the instrument yourself and try to see how it works. The experiment which we are looking at today is Michelson interferometer, which basically, as you can see, which was described in the regular session also for the lab, that there will be a light source and the instrument itself is here. The primary components are two mirrors and a glass plate, which probably you cannot see from that viewpoint, but I will be demonstrating this from another viewpoint as well, so that these things are clear. The light from the source hits the glass plate and gets split up into two roughly equal amplitude parts. The glass plate is partially covered with a reflective coating for this purpose. The part of the wavefront comes to this mirror and part comes to this mirror. And when these two mirrors reflect those wavefronts, the reflected wavefronts will combine together. And due to the difference in path between this mirror and the glass plate and the other mirror and the glass plate, the path difference causes a phase difference, and therefore you get interference between the two wavefronts which are combining after passing through this instrument. What we will be doing is we will be projecting this image onto a screen, and that is what we will be seeing. Okay, so let us have a look at some of the components in a little more detail. Okay.
So this is another viewpoint. This is exactly opposite to where we were just now. The camera is on the opposite angle. So this is the laser source. If it is switched on, you can see that slight greenish color is coming, or you can see the spot. Of course, this is not advisable, but should not bring your hand in the path of the laser a lot. But yeah, there is a laser. We'll be looking at more of that. And because a laser is a point source, it produces only a very thin beam and not a beam, not a large wavefront. So there is a lens here which will help to expand the laser beam into a wavefront. The reason we are using a laser is then it becomes easy to project onto a screen. Otherwise, the ordinary light sources we use are too feeble and you will not get anything on the screen. Okay. Once the light passes through this and expands into a wavefront, it goes to the interferometer, the actual interferometer. I think the camera panned too much, but okay. This is now clearly visible. Basically, you have the first mirror and the second mirror. So you have two mirrors. And you also have a glass plate here at the center. There is a second glass plate which we will discuss a bit later on. Or rather, it is a kind of homework for you to find out what is the purpose of that. Basically, the light travels, it hits the middle glass plate, which is called the beam splitter. The beam splits into two parts, one part traveling to the mirror M1, the other part traveling to the mirror M2. And these mirrors reflect the light back, and the light from this mirror is reflected towards the screen, and the light from this mirror is transmitted towards the screen. And so both of these beams will interfere. That is the basic idea which we are looking at. Of course, when the light source is turned on, what you will see is that some spots will be visible on the mirror, which are not very clear right now, but at least this small dot, green dot, which has appeared on both the mirrors is visible, and also some greenish light is visible on the glass plate. We'll be looking at this from a different viewpoint. Of course, for ideal conditions in this experiment, one should use a dark environment. So we will attempt to do that, even though this is not a dark room, it is an office, but we can still try to do that. So that will be our next part of this demonstration. So we can continue with that.
This is a same setup under dark room kind of conditions, and basically we are using some kind of agarbatti. You can see that somehow, yeah. So just to get a look at the laser beam, so you can see that whenever the small dust particles from, or the smoke from the agarbatti, when it is passing through the air, if you bring it close to the laser beam, you can see that, you can see actually the laser beam due to the scattering of laser light from those smoke particles. So you can actually visualize the, you can actually see the laser beam basically. So you can see that now the main laser beam is almost clearly visible. You can see the smoke particles traveling down the laser beam, and also where it hits on the mirror, and then how it gets reflected, and this is the screen. Of course, what I have done is I have removed this lens from the path of the beam, so that you only see a single laser beam and not a diffused beam, wavefront. But in the actual experiment, of course, you need a wavefront, but this is just a demonstration on the path which the light takes. There are some extra reflections from some glass plates which are coming in some random direction. So one has to take care of those as well while taking precautions so that someone else doesn't come in the path of the laser beam. I hope this is visible to some extent, and one can actually see the laser beam. I hope anyway. I don't know. But this is a very good way to visualize. If you are confused about something, just take a agarbatti or a dhoop is even better, and you can try to see where the beam is going. Of course, chalk dust also works, but if you keep banging a duster here, dust will go on the component, so that is not a good idea. Particulate smoke is a much smaller kind of particle, but also not a good idea to do long term, but at least for visualization it can be done. We'll now brighten the lights a little bit and try to look at how the fringe pattern actually looks. This is a view of the screen when the laser beam is directly incident on the two mirrors, and you will find that in general you will find two spots. One is because the laser beam reflected from one mirror, and the other is because of the laser beam being reflected from the other. Of course, you can superimpose a lens over here so that you can see the picture more clearly, and you can see that there are two spots, and in principle you can try to align these two spots by adjusting the mirrors. The adjustment of the mirrors I will demonstrate to you shortly, but basically you can align those dots to be exactly together. This is an extremely crucial step in setting the instrument. That is because if you have an extended source of light or a plane wavefront of light, there is no reason to assume that one portion of that wavefront is coherent or has some kind of phase relation with a different part of the same wavefront. If they are originating from a point source, then you expect this, but if they are originating completely independently, then you don't expect any such phase relation between them. Therefore, different parts of the same wavefront need not
actually have a proper phase relation with each other. Hence, if a wavefront is overlapped with a reflected version of itself, which is physically shifted, you need not get interference. For highly coherent sources, etc., you might, but there is no general reason to get. Therefore, it is necessary to first overlap these two so that when you introduce the beam expander lens in the path of the light, you immediately get a kind of picture which looks like this. As you can see, there are some fringes visible which are very, very fine. So, if you try to bring them a bit closer, by adjusting the mirrors, you can actually bring these lines into a better position. And you can see that these look like straight lines, but actually they are having some curvature. And if you adjust the mirrors further, you will find that you can bring the center of this curve or center of this curve in this to the center of your field of view. And you get this kind of interference. This is basically an interference pattern due to the expanded laser wavefront expanded through an expander lens, reflected from mirror A and reflected from mirror B and then superposed of each other. Because of the different path lengths which they travel as they hit one mirror or the other, you will find that this gives you this interference pattern. This interference pattern can be actually manipulated by either expanding or contracting the fringes. In this case, the fringes are contracting, and this happens when one of the mirrors is moved. So basically, our whole handle on the interference pattern is that if we move the mirror, the fringe pattern changes. And in fact, if you move the mirror by a distance which corresponds to a phase difference of, let us say, 2 pi or 360 degrees, then basically you get a repetition. So right now I have a bright fringe at the center. After some time again I have a bright fringe at the center. After some time again I have a bright fringe at the center, and so on. So you can keep on repeating this pattern. So when I move from this position to this position, basically one extra fringe has disappeared into the center. Basically, I have moved the mirror such that the path length is changed by an integral multiple of lambda. In this case, particularly, it is changed by exactly lambda amount. So, basically, you have an instrument whose capability for motion is so sensitive that it can move by a fraction of the wavelength. And therefore, when you move the mirror by a certain amount, what you get is that you have basically moved the mirror by one single count of lambda or one single wavelength. Actually, since the light travels through the mirror and back, so if you move the mirror by lambda by 2, the total path length changes by lambda. So your instrument is as sensitive as being able to move half a wavelength of light. And we'll see how this is achieved when we discuss the construction of this particular interferometer. But this is the basic idea which you have, that you can keep on moving this mirror and noting down by how much amount you have moved. For example, if you count the motion of 10 fringes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Now, if you had noted down your original reading and you are noting this one, the difference will tell you that the mirror moved by an amount which is equal to 10 lambda by 2, which is 5 lambda. And you can actually measure this on the instrument by how much actual amount the mirror was moved. And by comparing these two, you can obtain the value of lambda. This is the first important part of this experiment as such, that you have to count the fringes, and after the results of the fringe counting are with you, you have to obtain a numerical value for lambda. you have to obtain the wavelength of the light. This is the first part of the experiment with the Michelson interferometer. However, as you can see, a lot of skill is involved in actually setting up the instrument to give good quality fringes. So you can actually practically use this instrument whenever we reopen in physical mode. But right now, what will happen is that you will be given a data set from an actual experiment, and you will have to analyze it to obtain the fringes, which is itself having a lot of important lessons for data analysis. So anyway, that will be a very good exercise, and the skill development part, of course, can take place at a later stage whenever we reopen. Okay. Another aspect which we had partially noted earlier is that if you keep on moving these fringes, let us try to do that. If you keep on doing this for a very long time, you will find that sometimes the visibility of the fringes, right now the fringes visibility is very good. In the sense, the dark is really dark and the bright is really bright. But you will find that as you move the mirror, I mean, not very soon, but over several hundreds of fringes probably, you will find that the visibility changes. By visibility, you can define visibility as the intensity of the dark band, which is ideally zero, minus the intensity of the bright band, divided by their average value. So basically it is a measure of how well you can distinguish the dark band from the bright band. Right now it seems to be that the dark and bright band are very clearly different. The dark is really dark, the bright is really bright. But if you keep on moving like this for several hundreds of fringes, which is not going to happen very soon, but still, if you keep on persisting on that, you will find a situation which comes like this, where if you can notice, the fringes are still there, but very, very poor in visibility. That is, you can no longer distinguish clearly between the maxima and the minima. You can still make out that there are fringes because they are still collapsing into the center. I hope this is visible in the video as well. I mean, live itself it is barely possible to make out. Only when you move the fringes you actually realize you have fringes. Before that, if you just leave it as a plain standing pattern, you don't see anything. If you measure the distance between one such occurrence of a visibility minimum, that is where the visibility is very poor, and you keep on moving forward, you will come to a region where again visibility is better, and you can actually make out the difference. If you keep moving further, you will find the visibility becomes better and better, and as you move further, you will find that the visibility again starts becoming poorer. So here the visibility is excellent. Here again the visibility is gradually becoming poorer, and here again the visibility is very poor. Right now the visibility is extremely poor, you can hardly make out that there are some fringes. The reason why this happens is partly discussed in the class, and partly it is a homework, and the reference for this is given to you. It's a very simple and straightforward approach. But basically, when you measure the distance between successive visibility minima or visibility maxima, see, the minimum in visibility is very easy to see because fringes are not at all visible. That is the visibility minimum. Visibility maximum means fringes are of best quality. Now, best quality is a subjective thing. So it is always advisable to count the distance between successive such zones where you find that the visibility is close to zero. And on the basis of that, you can then calculate your bandwidth of the laser. That is, what is the delta lambda over which the wavelengths are spread. Because it's a semiconductor diode laser, it doesn't have the same sharp transitions like a atomic laser, like a helium neon laser or something. So it will have a few or a small band of wavelength over which the wavelength is spread, and you can find out this spread by measuring this visibility minimum. Okay, this is the second experimental part of the experiment. Of course, as discussed, it may not be possible to do that. So, well, whatever we can do, we should do. So, again, the data will be given to you, and then on the basis of that data, you have to make a quantitative estimate of what would be the spread of wavelength for that particular laser source. And then you can report this data. Even though you have not done the experiment, the data analysis therefore has to be quite extensive. Definitely bonus points if you figure out some real alternative way of doing the analysis. But even otherwise, a fair amount of professional approach, in some sense I would call it scientific professional approach, is expected. In the sense, treat it as a serious effort, not just like it is practical, is treated as something, oh, we have to anyway do it. It's not like that. There is a lot of learning objective behind this, and you should definitely take it very seriously. Basically, the learning objectives are such that these techniques of analysis will be useful even far into the future. So, do not take it lightly. Okay. Next, we'll have a quick look at the actual instrumental aspects, namely how to handle the mirrors and how the data is actually taken. So, we will do that next. As you can see, these are the two mirrors and these are two glass plates. This is the main beam splitter glass plate. This is a glass plate called the compensator, which you will have to read up about that and find out what is its purpose. That is a kind of homework for you. Each mirror has two screws behind it. This is one and this is the other. They are placed diagonally. This is at the top left and this is at the bottom right part of this bracket for holding the mirror. Similarly, there is one here at the top left and the bottom right. The bottom right is probably not visible, but the top left is visible. So there are two screws here as well. These screws control the horizontal and vertical alignment of the mirror. So this screw actually controls the horizontal tilt of the mirror, and the vertical tilt of the mirror, and this the horizontal orientation. So basically, if you touch this screw, the lower screw, the fringe pattern shifts, because the mirror shifts left and right, so the fringe pattern shifts left and right. Similarly, if you control the upper screw, then the fringe pattern will shift up and down because the mirror is shifting up. This can be used, as we saw, to bring the circular pattern into the center of the field of view. If you can see that a particular arc is visible, then you can adjust this and this to gradually bring the center of the circle from that arc into the field of view. By the way, I figured out that the second mirror screws are not visible. So, maybe that these are the screws of the second mirror. The camera position is slightly difficult to handle. So, these are to adjust the mirrors till you get the fringe pattern properly. Once you are getting the fringe pattern, then the next step is to be able to move the mirror. So, actually, there is a scale on this side. It is obviously not visible from the angle where the camera is viewing. But you can go back to the initial portion of the video where the side-on vision of the instrument is shown, where you can actually see this scale.
That is the main scale of the instrument, and the mirror position on that can be marked. And the main scale has remarkably very less role here, because as we saw, the capability of the instrument is to shift by few thousands of angstroms. Basically, the least count is actually 1000 angstroms, as we will find out. But basically, you can shift the mirror by some small fraction of the wavelength. So you can imagine that in the whole experiment, you will not be moving much along the main scale. So main scale is not really a very serious thing to look at, but you should definitely know that there is a main scale there if ever you need to find the distance. Purpose for which the main scale can be useful is, for example, if you use a polychromatic source like a mercury vapor lamp or a tungsten filament lamp, actually is a very good example, normal light bulb, then you can get something called colored fringes. It's a very interesting concept and an interesting, very nice to look at as well. Of course, if you actually try to do that, it's quite tough to get, and the main scale could be useful in such situations. I will not go into further details, but you can read about a lot of these things in some standard books, old optics books like Jenkins and White, etc. Anyway, trying to have a look at the main scale, if we try to zoom here, you will find that this is the main scale. If you keep rotating this, you will see that the divisions, I am not sure they are visible, but basically you have got ...50 here, now it is 60. Now it is 70, then 80, 90, and then 0, then 10, etc. So you can see that between one marking and the next, there are 10 equal markings. So these are basically, it is a scale divided into 100 equal divisions. And when you rotate it from 0 back to 0, you will find that the mirror moves along the main scale by 1 millimeter. Which means that when this completes 100 divisions or one complete revolution of this main scale wheel, to see the main scale wheel, we will have to undo. This is the main scale wheel. So basically what I was doing was like this. When you rotate the main scale wheel, you will find that when this completes 100 divisions, which is one complete revolution of this wheel, the mirror moves along the main scale by 1 millimeter, which means that the least count of this in millimeters is 0.01 millimeter. For obvious reason that this is basically dividing that 1 millimeter of the main scale into 100 equal parts, one division on this. So if you move by one division, basically you are moving the mirror by 100th of a millimeter, that is 0.01 millimeter. So that is this scale. Then there is another scale here on the side, which is also divided into 100 divisions. And when you rotate that by a complete rotation, that is 0 to 100, you will find that this scale moves by one division. Which means that this circular scale, the fine circle, this is called the coarse circular scale, this is the fine circular scale. The fine circular scale actually subdivides the circular scale into 100 equal parts. So basically this divides one division of this into 100 equal parts. This divides one division of the main scale into 100 equal parts. So basically you have got a total division of 100 by 100, which is 10,000. So what you are measuring is actually 1 by 10,000 of a millimeter. That is, millimeter is already 10 power minus 3 meters. So you are measuring the smallest division on this scale is basically a movement of the mirror by a very small amount, it is equal to 10 to the power minus 7 meters. 10 to the power minus 7 meters translates as 1000 angstroms if you convert them. So you can see that this division by 100 and this division by 100 together divide the 1 millimeter of the main scale into 10,000 equal parts. Each part is actually 1000 angstroms. This is achieved in a very simplistic way. Basically, this has a screw whose pitch is something like 100th of a meter, and this has a connecting gear wheel which interlocks with this one, which again has a gear ratio of 1:100. So it is not something very well. In its capability, it is quite remarkable, but from a technological viewpoint, it is not something very remarkable. It is something which can be done by conventional methods. So, in principle, if someone wants to start a factory of constructing Michelson interferometers for whatever reason, if they only want to do this kind of instrument, then it's very straightforward. What I'm trying to point out, it's not a technological wonder. The current day applications of Michelson interferometers are very much technological wonders. For example, two of the major points which I would like definitely put forward. One is that it is standard component in what are called Fourier transform instruments, particularly Fourier transform infrared spectrometers, which basically at the core of the instrument you have an interferometer, Michelson type interferometer. Then you have the LIGO, Large Interferometric Gravitational Observatory. There, the technology is extremely sophisticated. So, they take care of a lot of things. Basically, the gravitational wave signal from outer space which they try to detect is much, much smaller than the regular seismic activity of Earth, normal tectonic activity, etc. So, they have to be really careful and they do that. Okay? So, this was basically about the two scales which you read on. So, the data which will be provided to you will be main scale division, circular scale division and fine circular scale division. And from that you have to convert it into actual units where you can work with and then obtain the value of the wavelength. Similarly, for the visibility, you will be given the data in terms of main scale and four circular scale. You saw that fine circular scale hardly makes a difference to the visibility, but when you move this by certain amount, it does. And so, you will get the data in that form and you have to analyze that.
So, that basically concludes our discussion of the Michelson interferometer as far as the experimental and instrumental aspects are concerned. Hope the demo is useful to you, at least to visualize what exactly we are talking about, so that it does not seem like a merely data analysis exercise. Definitely, I hope that whenever we physically reopen, we can actually have a round of hands-on sessions with this instrument, maybe one day of the week or something like that. We'll definitely try to do that. Okay. Thank you very much.